So you want to visit the Antarctica? What does that actually mean? What does it entail? And how much would that cost? Stay tuned as I explain all these, coming up next. Hi fellow travelers, this is Ken and welcome to my channel, Ken Travels 360. Currently, I'm on an Antarctica expedition cruise with PONANT, and I've spent a lot of time researching a lot of aspects of Antarctica cruise. And I thought it would be useful to create a video to answer some of the questions that I had before, which I think many of you watching this video may have. A trip to the Antarctica is probably one of the most exciting journeys that one could make on Earth. However, traveling to Antarctica is never cheap, and for most people, it will be a once-in-a-lifetime trip. So make sure you have thought about all the aspects before booking such a trip. The Antarctica is a remote icy continent that is uninhabited by humans, and hence there is no infrastructure there apart from some research station. As a result, a visit there will entail going on a cruise. However, there are actually a myriad of choices when it comes to Antarctica cruises. They differ a lot in price, itinerary, and comfort level. First, you have ships that offer scenic cruising only. This is not an option you will encounter if you are looking for an expedition cruise line, but some of the more traditional cruise lines are offering itineraries that sail from South America down to Antarctica for a few days of scenic cruising. You will not get a landing and set foot in Antarctica. This is only a good option if you have mobility issues and cannot climb in and out of a Zodiac boat. It's also much cheaper, but I do feel it makes sense to save the money so that you can do a proper one. At the time of research, for example, Norwegian Cruise Line, they offer a 14-day Antarctica cruise starting from Buenos Aires, calling at Montevideo of Uruguay, Puerto Madryn of Argentina, followed by Punta Arenas of Chile, and then Ushuaia of Argentina in Tierra del Fuego. It then crosses a Drake Passage and scenic cruise around Elephant Island, and then returning to South America via stop at Falkland Islands, which is a tender port, before returning to Buenos Aires. For that cruise, you can get an inside stateroom from as little as £1,300, and a balcony stateroom will cost around £2,500. For 14 days accommodation and food and drinks, that's an incredible price. An expedition cruise will cost you a lot more, typically around $1,000 per day. Now, most people will actually want to do an expedition cruise to visit the Antarctica. Most Antarctica cruises will start from Ushuaia, capital of Tierra del Fuego, and nicknamed Fin del Mundo, which means end of the world. There are some Antarctica cruises that start from nearby Puerto Williams, which is in Chile though, so you're more likely to fly down from Santiago. In any case, this means you do have to budget for not only your return flight to Buenos Aires, but also from the Argentine capital, you need to take a domestic flight of around 3.5 hours to get to Ushuaia. Most people will probably also want to build an extended holiday in Argentina or South America around the cruise as well, as it takes a long time to fly to South America for most people. So that will of course add to the cost as well. The next question is the sea rough? To address it, first you have to understand that to visit Antarctica from South America, and that's the majority of the cruise, you have to cross the Drake Passage twice, once to reach the White Continent and once to return to South America. Now, what is the Drake Passage? Named after the famed British privateer Sir Francis Drake, the Drake Passage is an area of the Southern Ocean between the bottom of South America, Cape Horn, and the Antarctica Peninsula, which is the most northerly part of the White Continent. Now, if you look at the globe, you will see the Drake Passage is where the Pacific, Atlantic, and Southern Oceans converge. You will also see that there is no landmass between approximately latitude 55 south to 60 south, so you get really strong winds there. Now, this Drake Passage is 1,000 km long, so it usually takes 1.5 days or maybe 2 days to cross. However, it really depends on the sea conditions. Sometimes it can be calm, then they say it's either the Drake Shake or the Drake Lake. When it's a Drake Lake, the journey will be really enjoyable with small waves and light winds, and you can just enjoy it like on a regular cruise, going out on the deck, wildlife spotting, etc. But if it's Drake Shake, let's just say I hope you have brought your seasickness pill with you. For us, we experienced somewhat in the middle between Drake Shake and Drake Lake. For a lot of people, crossing the Drake Passage is a rite of passage. It's a bucket list item to take off. It gives you a taste of what explorers back in the days felt like. However, if you are really rich and you're determined to skip this part, then there are shortcuts. A few expedition cruise lines, typically the really high-end ones, offer visitors the option to fly directly to King George Island to join the cruise there. This way, you save 2 days each way and you don't experience the Drake Passage. About 10% of visitors to the Antarctica do it that way. It will add thousands of pounds or dollars to the price though. As far as I know, Quark Expeditions and Silver Sea both offer this option. But beware that while it may be nice to avoid the Drake Passage, if the weather is bad, the planes themselves might be delayed. The next question is probably which cruise itinerary to choose. Almost all the itineraries will visit the Antarctic Peninsula. After crossing the Drake Passage, your ship will visit a few different landing sites on both the mainland and some of the surrounding islands. You can expect to see penguins, icebergs, seals maybe, and a lot of dramatic scenery. For most people, this will be enough. If you have the extra time and budget, then you can select an itinerary that includes South Georgia. What is the reason to visit this remote island, South Georgia, that is 800 miles to the east of the Falklands? During the summer breeding season, South Georgia is home to millions of macaroni penguins, hundreds of thousands of king penguins, and millions of fur seals. For me personally, I think if I had more time and money, then I might have chosen an itinerary that included South Georgia. But I hadn't, so I had to make do with photos and images of that. Beyond that, if you are super rich and adventurous, you could also visit the other side of the Antarctica from Australia or New Zealand. In this case, you voyage into the Ross Sea, where you can see emperor penguins and a few other things that you won't normally see on an Antarctica cruise from Ushuaia. And finally, if you have a month free and happy to spend around £35,000 per person, you can do a half circumnavigation cruise from Ushuaia to Lyttelton in New Zealand on board Le Commandant Charcot or PONANT, for example. The next question is when to book. Visiting Antarctica, at least as a tourist, is only really possible from November to maybe early March. Due to the limited duration of the season, the range of itineraries, and generally quite high demand, many Antarctic cruises can sell out quickly, particularly the cheaper staterooms. It's recommended to book as early as possible. A lot of people book 1 to 2 years in advance. Because of COVID, I only booked this in February 2022 for a cruise in December the same year. Now, it's possible you could find some bargains if you leave it till really late. At the last Black Friday sale, I saw a couple of cruise lines offering a big discount on some of the Antarctica cruises that were not selling well, but these tend to be away from the peak season, and many of them were for March, the tail end of the season. So you can gamble, but remember, flight prices could be expensive if you buy it very late. And for many people, they'll need to arrange their PTOs early if they are going to be away for 2-3 weeks at least. At this point, I'd like to pause and ask you to hit the like button. The more people do that, the more YouTube will spread this video to a wider audience, and that will help out the channel a lot. And if you haven't done so, please subscribe to my channel now, and also hit the bell icon to activate the notifications. The next question many people have is when is the best time to visit? Obviously, you need to pick a time that is convenient to yourself too. But after that, let's see what different months offer in terms of scenery and animals present. As mentioned, the cruising season doesn't really start until November. because you need the pack ice surrounding the continent to break up first. November for many cruise lines is therefore when the Antarctica season kicks off. Landing sites will tend to have pristine snowy landscape. The days are lengthening and penguin chicks are only starting to hatch. If your cruise includes South Georgia, then this is the best time to see elephant seals courting as well as penguins mating. This is a great time to spot iceberg. However, at landing site, the deep snow can make it quite difficult to walk through. December is arguably the best month to visit the White Continent. The temperatures are approaching the warmest in the year. Well, by Antarctic standard anyway. There are long hours of daylight and wildlife is active everywhere. We're visiting around the solstice and it's almost never got dark. The cruises are normally the most expensive, particularly over Christmas and New Year. For some strange reason though, our one, which is from the 17th to 27th of December, it was surprisingly one of the cheapest ones offered by PONANT when I was looking at booking with them. However, one of the drawbacks is that flights to Argentina are going to be very expensive. We definitely experienced that. Luckily, we have some avios to redeem flights with British Airways. The first half of the month will be similar to November, but from mid-month, the wildlife really starts to boom and lots of penguins and seals will be out and about. January is another peak month for Antarctic cruises, and that does mean the prices will reflect that. Don't expect to find a bargain for sailing this month. You can see lots of fluffy grey penguin chicks, and you could spot seals and whales. Alongside with late December, the weather is likely to be the best this month. But remember, weather in Antarctica is largely unpredictable though. February is the best month for whale watching in Antarctica, and it's still possible to see penguin chicks. By this point in the season, you won't have problems with sea ice anymore, and this is probably the best month for cruises that venture beyond the Antarctic Circle. Days are starting to get shorter, which means you get a chance to experience dramatic sunsets that last hours. That will be a delight to many photographers. What these photographers won't appreciate though is the condition on land. While many of the glaciers are still bright white, the rocky shores where the cruise ship make landings will have far less snow and far more mucky guano or penguin droppings. March is when the tourist season is winding down. You will see fewer and fewer ships as the month progresses. The weather is starting to get colder again and you won't be seeing penguin chicks anymore. However, it's still a fantastic time to spot whales and you will spot loads of fur seals too. The snow cover will be at its lowest, so this is perhaps not the month to see the White Continent at its most photogenic. Cruise fares are also likely to be lowest too. So which cruise line run Antarctica expedition cruise? Which one should you choose? Size is the most important factor in choosing your type of experience. IATO, International Association of Antarctica Tour Operations, guidelines dictate that ship carrying more than 500 passengers cannot land passengers ashore. Therefore, larger ships from traditional cruise lines can only spend several days scenic cruising with no landings. Most expedition lines ships are much smaller, carrying around or less than 200 passengers, and they use zodiac boats so that the passengers can set foot on the White Continent. So for example, the cruise ship I'm on, the Boreal, it can theoretically carry up to 256 maximum passengers, but on this cruise there are only 200 passengers, which is very lucky because the IATO rules also dictate that only 100 passengers can go on a zodiac boat and land ashore at one time. So with 200 passengers we'll have to go in two groups, but if we just have a few more passengers then we'll have to have three groups, which means everyone will get to spend less time on shore. So this is where you pay more money. The smaller the boat, the fewer the number of people, and the more time you get to spend on land in Antarctica. Here are some of the more famous cruise line that offer Antarctica expeditions. First, you have Limbach Expedition. They are the first company to run expedition trips to Antarctica, so they have lots of experience. Their ships are small and they have a great expedition team. They even have a National Geographic photographer on every cruise. However, they're very expensive. Their cheapest stateroom is $16,000. Next, you have PONANT. They are French and they specialize in intimately sized, luxurious, small ships, all flying under the French flag. Their fleet of small expedition ships has good hardware. The French touch is exemplified by the presence of French naval officers, elegant cuisine, and great interior design. They are well known also for their excellent off-vessel expedition program. French and English are spoken on board, so you don't need to be able to speak French. Then you have Quark Expeditions. They're experts in polar expeditions. In fact, they run just Arctic and Antarctica sailings only. Like Silver Sea, they run the option of flying to King George Island. When I was researching this, they have a Black Friday sale and some of the prices are actually 50% off. As a result, I was seeing prices as low as £6,300 for some of their classic Antarctica Peninsula cruise. Quartz also includes the polar plunge once during each voyage. A lot of the high-end cruise lines don't do that anymore, so if you have your heart set to do a polar plunge, that's something to bear in mind. Then you have Silver Sea. They are all inclusive, very luxurious, and offer the possibility to fly between Punta Arenas and King George Island, avoiding the Drake Passage. Otherwise, while being quite expensive in general, they include a night pre-cruise hotel in Santiago and charter return flights from Santiago to Puerto Williams, all food and beverages, all shore excursions, all expedition gear, and butler service in the suites. When I did the research, I was actually a bit surprised how competitive their prices are, considering what they include in their itinerary. There are many others, cruise line as well. I will put a link of the ones I know in the description. But anyway, the message is that different cruise lines are very similar, but yet differ in the level of service, the inclusions, the atmosphere, and everything. Depends on your budget, your travel preference, there is bound to be one that will match your requirements. Right, I think I'll end the video here now. If you've got any more questions, please post them in the comments below. And remember, click the like button before leaving this video. Thank you for watching. See you in the next video. Ciao.